We're back for the boys, 2010, having the Castle semifinal from Castle Lanes. And boy, Phil Anko, the proprietor here, is going to be pretty proud. Two of his house bowlers, David and Ryan, making this match, Joey. And I got to say, odds on favorites right now is David coming off that nice last game.
Well, exactly. He's the front runner here. And I mean, both players on their bio sheets wanted to. Special mention to Phil Anko for all his support and help over the years.
Ooh, and a little fast eight there.
Okay, now we might be seeing a little bit of breakdown on the pattern, or he just threw a little too good.
Yeah, look at that ball just drive right through, barely got the nine pin out, and lucky to just leave that 4-7.
All right, so a typical adjustment, Phil?
Typical adjustment, just move, and this pattern right now, I just simply move my feet one board to the left. And that was pretty rare for David to just get up there and chuck a spare away like that.
Right, and the reason you say one board, I'm sure, is if you make a two or three board move, your launch angle changes dramatically and you swing the ball into no man's land.
Exactly. With the lack of oil on this pattern, during a league play, you may make a two-and-one move because you can take advantage of the dry to the right. You can't take advantage of any dry on this pattern because there really isn't any outside of 10th board like you see in league. And is he going to roll that two-pin out? Gets it to wiggle.
Yeah, and I'll tell you, less revs, it's a 2-4-8-10, whereas with his rev rate, it's a simple 2-pin.
Yeah, playing just slightly outside of David's line, but they're pretty similar in area. Down lane, Ryan's taking a little more direct approach to get there. You can see he's standing a little farther right on the approach, straight at the spare, a little problem with the footwork, but he covers it up nicely.
And direct is good. The easier the lanes are, it seems you can hook it more and open up the lane, and when the pattern is tougher and flatter, you best off go direct. The nice thing about Ryan's game, he's 16 years of age, Phil, but physically, he has the game of a 30-year-old.
Oh, I mean...
And by that, I mean poised, great tempo, great balance, and it looks like he's been bowling for 30 years.
Yeah.
On that shot. We will discount that shot. But everyone throws a bad pitch now and then, even CC Sabathia.
Yeah, and it's going to be magnified on this pattern. On a house shot, that may have come back and just tickled the head pin and maybe just left the two. But now you look at the great bloodline in this family. You've got his dad, Matt, Racine Bowling Association Hall of Famer. You know, you've got the great support of proprietor Phil Anko that lets the kids practice for cheap and when they're done working at Castle, if they work there or if they're done with their junior leagues. You got Lenny Borsch, who's a phenomenal bowler and coach, helping these kids out too. You can see why David and Ryan here, really superstars in the making.
Right, and don't forget, Lenny's a great ball driller as well. And, I mean, you need all three for the complete package down there, and the kids are getting it. You know? Yeah. Good support from family.
And that's just right
on. The more we talk about it, the worse the shots are getting. But, again, viewers, you got to realize that's a one or two board error, which we all make, and the ball has no chance for recovery.
Yeah. So.
Now, did he possibly, do you think David might have moved in a little bit on the right lane because it finished too deep on the left lane?
I think he did at least a board, if not two, but then
because, again, the ball that came high was on lane 21, not on lane 22.
Yep.
You have to treat each lane independently.
And we saw on the girls' show, we've seen on other shows here from Castle Lanes in the past, lane 21 always seems to play a little bit tighter than lane 22 does.
And we know from experience that it can be a topography of the lane, meaning the tilt of the lane may not be dead level, both lanes, I'm saying.
Yep.
And the ball goes uphill on one lane, a little bit downhill on the other, and even though the oil pattern is the same, the lanes can play oppositely.
And right through the nose again, lucky to leave just a 6-10.
Right, and in fact, in our league Monday night, Phil, we were on 9-10, the classic lanes in Oak Creek. The pair started out even. Midway through game one, the right lane got tighter. The left lane got 3-4 boards drier.
And then you got to make sure you're really paying attention because you can go from shooting a ton one game to shooting a buck 30 the next if you're not paying attention.
Happens all the time, and that doesn't exclude the PBA players.
Yeah, I mean, you do have some pretty good players in that Flat Earth League at Classic Lanes Oak Creek. I mean, there's some guys that used to be on the regional tour.
Well, we have PBA exempt player Dave Barris, and Dave is solid. I'll tell you, he doesn't shoot too many sets under 580 no matter what we put out there.
Oh, my. How about that huge break for Ryan right there? Goes through the nose. Something shoots back across the pin deck and takes out the 6-10.
Right, so he saves count and gets a nice mark because that spare wouldn't have been a gimme.
Yep. And instead of maybe getting back to an even match with David, Ryan maintains that 11-pin lead.
Right. And again, you know, we always remember the bad breaks, but will he remember that good break in frame three?
We'll remind him during the commercial break.
Well, let's see if he can take advantage of it. And he does. Now, that's a sign of a good player right there.
Yeah, and he's playing the lanes in the front part of the lane, what's commonly called the heads, the first 15 feet, playing it much more direct towards that second arrow area than we're seeing with Ryan, who's in around fourth arrow where the ball's laying down, and the ball gets out past third arrow, just past the arrows. So Ryan may have found something in practice. But
elbow in tight, hand behind the ball, a good shot. I think he just overthrew it a little bit, though. And again, the right lane for him is playing tighter.
Yep.
The left lane, he's going high, back-to-back shots.
So you can't lose your composure here, especially because you just gave away 4 pins and count working on a spare. And there's a lot of, we've seen it before. I mean, buckets are made a lot of ways, and they're missed in a lot of ways.
We're going to miss it sometimes more often than we're going to make it. And there, that's a great attempt. And you bad break, you chop it.
That's probably the worst way to miss it. You're right on top of the 2-pin. You know the ball's going to get back to the 8, and you just have that little extra angle with the ball, and you leave the 5.
Now the hand's on top of the head. He's going, what am I doing? I'm digging a hole against a pretty darn good bowler. You can't spot them pins.
No, and he's making a ball change here. He's got, looks like purple and white out there. I believe that's a...
Well, he's 40 pins down. I mean,
big curve, I think?
It looks like a lane one big curve.
Yeah.
And it's a real rolly ball. It kind of gets into the rev rate pretty quick. It's not skid flip, so it should be very arcing in motion. I don't know if it's the best choice from inside, as you can see. And
just never picked up the lane at all.
Right. And right now, I mean, he's grasping a little bit, but it's not always equipment. Sometimes when you're not targeting accurately, it's you.
Well, let's see if we can get this spare going into the commercial break and covers it up nicely. But he's got a big hole to dig himself out of, with Ryan come up in his half of the fifth frame when we return from Castle Lanes in Racine.